Assignment 1 in part A, this should be the second, the middle equation should be n omega equals k. Problem 2, part A, n omega equals k in this middle equation or middle expression. There you go. Okay, has anyone not received the handout, the course handout? Anyone else? Thank you. Sure. Do you need one? Okay. Okay, so today onwards we'll have our lectures in this class, and let's start with our where we left in the previous class, which is different classes of policies and dynamic programming problem. So we had history dependent randomized, where mu t was a function of h t, and it outputted a probability distribution over u. So it takes the entire history into account. So the policy at time t takes the entire history into account and outputs a distribution over all the actions. And then you toss a coin and act according to that distribution. And this was m HR, and then we had history dependent deterministic mu t is a function from HT to U. This was denoted by M HD, and then Markov or memoryless randomized, where mu t was a function from s to u. This is mr, and the same thing with this should be delta over u, and then deterministic, where mu t is a function from s to u. Okay, so these are the four classes of policies. We studied the obvious inclusion. So Markov deterministic is included in history-dependent deterministic, which is part of history-dependent randomized. So this is the most general class of policies. And then memoryless randomized is a part of, so Markov deterministic is part of Markov randomized, which is part of history-dependent randomized. So there is an obvious inclusion. So the first thing that I want to talk about, let's also write down the objective function. So we wanted to minimize expected value of summation of C IT UT IT plus 1 T equals 0 to capital T plus CT plus 1 IT plus 1. Okay, so this is my cost function. Okay, the first result that I want to show, I'm not going to completely show, but I'm going to go through the proof outline, is the following result. So remember, I had promised to show that even if we try to minimize this objective function over MHR, there is no loss of generality in actually restricting yourself to Markov deterministic strategies. So let's try and prove this result. So the first theorem is, for every initial state I naught in S, for every mu prime in MHR. So remember that mu prime is a collection of strategies. So mu prime equals to mu prime 1, mu prime 2, mu prime capital T. And this is in MHR. So these are all history-dependent randomized policies. There exists a mu equals to mu. Oh, I should start from mu 0 because my time index starts from 0. So mu 0, mu 1, mu capital T in Markov randomized such that probability under mu prime of IT and UT given I0 is the same as probability under mu IT UT given I0. Okay, so no matter what my initial condition is, and no matter which history-dependent randomized policy I can pick, there always exists a Markov randomized strategy. So remember, this is not Markov deterministic yet, it's just Markov randomized, such that this distribution is the same as this particular distribution. So this distribution is obtained by using the history-dependent policy mu prime, and this distribution is obtained, this conditional distribution is obtained using the Markov randomized policy mu. So in order to prove this result, we first have to explicitly construct this particular policy using mu prime and using the fact that we start from I naught. So any thoughts what a candidate mu t would look like? Okay, so my question is, I need to construct this policy, right, in order to show this equality under the policy. So my question is, what should a candidate mu t would look like? Any attempts? You have? No? Okay. Okay, so mu t is a Markov randomized strategy. I am going to define mu t at it as probability under mu prime of, I'm going to write ut given it and I0. So of course this is a distribution, so let me just write it as mu t it ut. So by defining my mu t in this way, I have forced this mu t to be Markov randomized, right? But the construction is using mu prime explicitly. Any questions so far? Sorry? I0, because this particular policy would depend on what initial condition you started with, or at least some distribution of the initial condition that you started with.
So distribution also.
Yeah. Okay. So typically in most problems, the initial condition is kind of known. You're sending a rocket to space, you will start from Earth or some specific point on Earth. Or if you're starting a data center, you will start with zero jobs in the queue, right? So I0 is pretty much known in most situations, the initial condition. Okay, so if I define it this way, it's not difficult to see that mu t is a Markov randomized strategy, and then you use induction to prove the result. So basically, you show that I0, U0, I1, U1, I2, U2, if you collect all those, compute all those probabilities under the influence of mu prime, and then substitute this particular mu t everywhere, and due to this particular result for all the previous time steps, you will be able to prove the result very easily. It just requires quite a bit of algebra, but induction will allow you to prove all of it very quickly. Okay? Is the base step clear for this case? So what's the base step? Let me just do the base step. In the base step, you want to show that probability of mu I0 U0 given I0 equals to probability U0 given I0 under mu multiplied by probability of, yeah, actually that's because I0 is known, so you don't have to multiply it with anything. And this is the same as probability under mu prime of U0 given I0 because of the way I have constructed mu t from mu prime. Okay, and then you can assume that it holds for all time steps from 0 to t minus 1, and then prove it for time step t. Very straightforward calculation. Any question? Okay, so that's theorem 1. What's the upshot? So the upshot is theorem 2, which says that let me write it as a corollary. It's not really a theorem 2. So this is my J. Let me call this J of mu. So J of mu prime is equal to J of mu. Of course, the J starts, I0 is again fixed, so let me start the J with I0. So J of mu prime is equal to J of mu. If you start from I0. Okay. How does this equality help us prove this result? So let's write out this whole expectation thing. So I'm going to write it here. So expected value under mu prime of summation of C of IT UT IT plus 1. Let's set CT plus 1 equal to 0 for simplicity, because this can be absorbed. Let's just ignore CT plus 1 for the time being. So let's set CT plus 1 equal to 0. So this given I0 under the policy mu prime, this is equal to summation, this is T equals 1 to capital T, summation T equals 1 to capital T, summation IT UT IT plus 1 CIT UT IT plus 1 into probability IT UT IT plus 1 given I0, and this probability is computed using mu prime. T equals 0, yeah, T equals 0. Now what's going to help us? So we have this result. I can construct mu such that these two probabilities are equal, and I've shown that by induction. How does that help us here? Any thoughts? So let's try to disintegrate this. Okay, I'm going to disintegrate this. I'm going to write this as P of mu prime IT plus 1 given IT UT I0 multiplied by probability under mu prime of IT UT given I0. Okay? Any questions so far? Now, who can help? What should the next step be? Yeah.
Well, the trivial next step is that the last of the two probability statements in that line can be rephrased according to the Markov policy.
Right. What about the first one? That still has mu prime in it. Yes. That's right. It doesn't depend on the policy, and in particular, it doesn't depend on I0 as well, because it's a Markov decision problem, right? So this is the same as P of IT, IT plus 1, UT. This is the transition, probability transition state, no, state transition function, or transition probability matrix, yeah, that's the right word. So this is transition probability matrix, which doesn't depend on I0, and it doesn't depend on mu prime. It is something that is fixed and part of the description of the system itself. Okay? So we have a Markov process, so state transition doesn't depend on initial state, it doesn't depend on the policy that you have picked, as long as the action is given, UT is given. And so this is just a number independent of mu prime. And as far as this term is concerned, I can construct a corresponding mu so that that equality holds. So this P mu prime is equal to P of P mu. And therefore, this whole thing now is independent of mu prime, only depends on mu, and this is equal to expected value of mu of the entire cost function given I0, given the initial state. Yes? Yes, this is the joint distribution to begin with, yeah. Oh, because this is, this random variable is dependent on these two random variables. So you can't disintegrate the two completely. So you can't write it, this is not equal to P of IT plus 1 given I0 multiplied by P of IT UT given I0. It's not correct because IT plus 1 is dependent on IT and UT, and therefore you need to condition it. And that's what I'm doing. Okay. This would be true, by the way, in multi-arm bandit. We are going to cover multi-arm bandit sometime later, where the state is decoupled from one time step to another. So we will talk about it in the future. But right now, this is not the case. Okay, any questions so far? Yes?
This being able to use the transition probability matrix is only because the process is itself an MDP.
Yes, exactly.
So if the process was not right. Markov, then none of this.
Then none of this would be true, and that's what I think Matthew had mentioned in the previous class. If you have a non-Markov process, you augment the state with a lot of previous states in order to make it a Markov decision problem. Okay, so then your state space description is going to blow up. Okay, so far we still haven't reached Markov deterministic. So all I have shown is that no matter what history dependent randomized policy you pick, I can give you a Markov policy, Markov randomized policy that will achieve the same cost. So therefore, there's no point minimizing something over a much larger space because you can get essentially the same result in a much smaller space. So that's good. I still want to get to Markov deterministic. Okay, I don't want to be stuck in Markov randomized. So in order to get that Markov deterministic policy, what should my UT be? So what I want to say is, if I find an optimal Markov randomized policy, how can I construct a Markov deterministic policy that would give me the same cost? Yes.
The maximum likelihood, like the most likely.
Right. So not most likely. So here is the trick. But you are on the right track. So if mu star in MR is optimal, then pick mu as follows. So I'll pick mu t of it. No, this is pick mu in MD. I'm going to write it as mu tilde because it's a Markov deterministic. So mu tilde IT is basically some element in the support of mu T star IT. Okay, all of you are familiar with support of a distribution? support of a distribution. So if I have a probability if I have a real line, so 0, 1, 2, 3, and I have a probability distribution that's 1 over 4, 3 over 4, and 0 on 0 and 3, then the support of this distribution, so let me call this distribution lambda, then support of lambda is 1, 2. Okay, so these are the points at which you your probability distribution gives a positive value. Okay. So support, let me just write it explicitly. Support is U of T such that mu star T I T UT is positive, strictly positive, not greater than or equal to 0. This has to be strictly greater than 0. So if you do that, what you will get is maybe lemma. What you get is J of mu star is equal to J of mu tilde. And remember, mu tilde is Markov deterministic. And let me tell you why this would hold, why this should be true. Okay? So here is a simple result. Let AI, I equals 1 to n, be a sequence in R, and PI, I equals 1 to n, be some probability distribution function, so summation of PI is equal to 1. Then max of I, AI, should be greater than or equal to summation of PI, PJ, J equals 1 to N, and then min over I of AI is less than or equal to summation PJ, AJ. So the maximum value would be greater than or equal to the average value, and the minimum value will be less than or equal to the average value. Okay, we expect that to happen. Right? This is averaging, and this is maximum, this is minimum, and this is average. So we expect minimum to be less than or equal to average, we expect maximum to be greater than or equal to average. So because of that reason, you can actually prove this particular result. Yeah?
So in the first class, you talked about how there were some circumstances where you wanted the randomness.
Yes.
And
yeah.
Your answer. And if we're saying that these problems are all reducible down to, you know, the deterministic form, then what do we have to change in the original problem statement that forces that randomness for the adversarial advantage?
Yes. So the question is, when do you need randomness to be when would randomness be optimal? And in that case, when you have randomness, you have an adversary here, AT. So in your cost function, you will have IT, UT, AT, which is the adversary's action, and then IT plus 1. And so because of adversary's action, you want to confuse the adversary, so you will have to randomize your action. So for instance, in table tennis, you don't just start throwing the ball in the same direction. You always have to randomize between left and right in order to confuse your adversary in that situation. Okay. So that's one case. The other case where randomness would appear would be when you are doing exploration, but we haven't reached that point yet. So we'll reach it in perhaps in a month time. So when we are exploring, and the purpose of exploration is when you don't know this matrix, transition matrix, then you have to explore in order to identify what the transition matrix looks like, or compute the transition matrix, or estimate the transition matrix from real data, and that's when randomizing would help you. But besides that, if you know the system very well, randomization doesn't help. Okay. All right. So what we have learned from this exercise is, even if we start our optimization with the most general class of policies, which is history-dependent randomized policy, we have shown here a series of results which tells you that you should just stick to Markov deterministic policies, because that would achieve the optimal cost you could ever achieve in the optimization problem. Okay? So Markov deterministic wins. MMD wins. Now let's look at the complexity of this policy space. I'm going to erase this. So let's say your state space S is, n dimension, your state, the action space, not n dimension, but you have n points in the state space. So we are looking at finite state space setting. So you have n states, and you have, let's say, p actions. What's the number of policies, mu t, from S to U? So what's the cardinality of this space? P raised to? No. It is U raised to S, so P raised to N. Okay, so that's the number of points, number of policies that you have. Okay? So that's the number of policies. Now let's look at a history-dependent policy. So number of, well, I guess I don't need to put the number here because I've already put the notation. So mu t, which maps st cross ut minus 1 to u, the total complexity is p raised to n raised to t, and p raised to t minus 1. Okay. So at every point of time, this particular space continues to grow with respect to t. Okay, so as you increase the value of t, the number of possible policies increase exponentially or super exponentially, whereas in this case, it remains fixed. The number of policies remains fixed. Okay, it doesn't grow. So if you were sitting in a class in 1930s, this result would be revolutionary because you don't have to look in a much larger space. You just have to restrict yourself to a much smaller space of strategies and optimize the problem over that small space. Okay. Now let's look at another way of determining the complexity. Let's say you started with a problem with fewer states, and then because of the nature of the problem, you were forced to augment the state or increase the state space. The number of policies then also increases exponentially, right? And that is called as curse of dimensionality, which is as the state space expands, the number of policies expand like exponentially, and now you have to do comparison over a much larger number of possible situations. It increases the computational complexity significantly.
So the first line of the complexity analysis is Markov deterministic. Is there a similar bound that can easily be constructed for the Markov randomized, or does it come down to what assumptions we make about the probability distribution we're going to allow?
So Markov randomized is another ball game, because then your U, the space U there, is actually delta of U. So this is delta of U. And so you cannot really count it. It's an uncountable set. Okay. So the complexity is much, much higher there. OK. So this is known as curse of dimensionality. From now onwards, until we hit multi-agent reinforcement learning, we are only going to talk about Markov deterministic policies. Okay, so we'll restrict ourselves to Markov deterministic. And so now whenever I say policy, it will always be Markov deterministic policy. It will never be a randomized policy. Oh, actually, when we are doing exploration, then we will again use randomized policy. But until then, we are going to restrict ourselves to deterministic policy. All right, so now I'm going to talk about dynamic programming. And I'm going to rush through this particular section because it was covered in 5.7.5.9. So dynamic programming is a backward recursive algorithm for computing the value function and optimal policy. So VT plus 1 is given by the terminal cost, whatever that may be. And then you recursively define VT of IT as min over U expected value. Let me not write the expected value. Let me just write it as a summation. J in S C I T U J plus V T plus 1 into PIT J, and this is summation over all J in S. This minimization is over all actions. So recursively define the value function. So these are known as value functions. and the optimal policy mu t star of it is argmin u in capital U. It should be in the set of argmin of this whole thing. And the result, the main theorem of dynamic programming algorithm is that this is optimal, and V0 of I0 is the optimal cost. Mu star equals to mu 0 star, mu t star. This is in Markov deterministic class, is optimal. And V0, I0 is the optimal cost. Optimal policy. Yes?
The argument isn't over anything. Are you saying it's over VT?
This argument is over the entire set, U.
Okay, so of all the VTs.
That's right, yeah. So the min is stored as a value function and argmin is stored as the policy itself. Okay. So this operator, which is min over this summation, this will be used heavily throughout this class, throughout this course, and it is known as the Bellman operator. So I'll just write the Bellman operator rigorously. So T of VT plus 1 is given by this whole thing. Let me just write it here. This is T of VT plus 1 of IT, which is this whole minimum thing. This, oh, capital, have I used capital T already? Oh, I screwed up. Okay. So this is, this will be used for Bellman operator. This is Bellman operator. And of course, this terminal time, capital T, is going to go away very soon. Actually, in the next 2 minutes, this terminal time will go away. And so this T will be reserved exclusively for Bellman operator. Okay? No operator overload. Okay. So far we have already talked about finite horizon stuff. So in finite horizon, the key ideas are Markov deterministic is sufficiently good. You don't have to go to history dependent randomized. You have an algorithm to compute the optimal policy, and it also computes the optimal cost as a byproduct. The third important thing was that at every point of time, your policy has dimension p raised to n, or not the dimension, but the number of policies you can have is p raised to n. Next, we are going to talk about infinite horizon problems. So infinite horizon problems. And in infinite horizon problems, the key idea is there is no terminal time. So And there are three specific types of infinite horizon problems. One is total cost MDP, discounted cost MDP, and then average cost MDP. Okay. So in total cost MDP, has everyone written or you're still writing? Okay, so in total cost MDP, let's say my mu was mu 0, mu 1, mu 2, goes all the way to mu infinity. Okay, so now I have a lot of policies, not policies, but decision rules. So my policy consists of an infinite sequence of decision rules. And my total cost MDP, my cost function J of mu, it is given by expectation of summation t equals 0 to infinity, C of it, ut, it plus 1. In the discounted cost, my J of mu is given by expected value of summation t equals 0 to infinity. I'll use alpha as a discount factor. Alpha raised to t, C of it, ut, it plus 1. In the average cost, my J of mu is lim sup n goes to infinity, expected value of 1 over n summation of t equals 0 to n minus 1, C of it, ut, it plus 1. Okay. So total cost MDP. I want to go from here to Dublin or some restaurant in Dublin by spending minimum possible time. Okay. What's the key characteristic of this particular problem? So I want to go in minimum possible time. Okay. So time is something that gets added. So this C of it, ut, it plus 1 is equal to 1. Okay, until I reach the destination. What happens when I reach the destination? Sorry? Zero cost. Okay, so as soon as I reach my destination, I don't have to accrue any more cost. So what that implies is in problems with total cost MDP, you have a state which is a terminal state. As soon as you reach the terminal state, you don't accrue any cost anymore. Okay? I want to go from here to Mars. I want to reach a specific point in Mars. And as soon as I reach there, I'm not accruing any cost anymore. Okay? My rocket is not spending any fuel after that. So that's the characteristic of total cost MDP. There is a terminal state And as soon as I reach the terminal state, there is no accrual of cost, and I remain in that terminal state forever. Okay, I don't go out of that state again. So there is a notion of terminal state. Okay, let's look at discounted cost MDP. I want to retire at some point of time, that's 30, 40 years later, and I have to save up money now in order to retire and have a comfortable life after retirement. If I have to eat a sandwich in Subway or Potbelly, Potbelly is actually my favorite. So if I have to eat a sandwich at Potbelly, I have to think whether I should spend $7 now or have $70 at my retirement so I could eat in a very expensive restaurant, maybe a fine dine restaurant at that point in time. How would I make a decision? It's a tough choice. Okay. Should I go and eat Potbelly sandwich now, which I really like, or should I save the money, invest it in some mutual fund, and after 40 years, eat in a very expensive restaurant? What do you think should the answer be? What would you do?
I'm
right.
Just decaying things over, and that goes into
right.
The alpha factor.
Right.
And it's, if I could have $700 later, I'd be interested, but if I'm going to have less than that, I'll pass it.
Okay. So his reasoning is, if I could get $700 at my retirement, I'll probably not eat the sandwich, stay hungry, and have some food at retirement. Or if I'm getting less than $700, then I'll probably eat the sandwich. Stay hungry after retirement. Maybe not stay hungry, but not go to an expensive restaurant. Okay, so there is a notion of discounting in this case. So something that's going to happen 40 years later, I perhaps don't really care about it right now. Okay, unless the returns are really good. And that notion of discounting is usually captured by this discount factor, which means that I'm more worried about what I have to do now that has much higher significance for me than what's going to happen 30, 40, 50 years later. Okay. So this discount factor allows you to discount the benefit that you will get in the future in order to do something today. So, okay, so in this case, future is not as important in the discounted MDP. Let's come to average cost MDP. Okay, so in average cost, the entire history, not the history, but the entire future is weighed equally, and that weight is equal to 1 over n. Okay? So it means that future is as important as today. Okay? When is this formulation useful? When is future as important as today?
When you're doing something, there's an element of risk, but it's risk intolerant as a whole, and you care about any risk occurring at any given point, and you're weighting against that. So,
Okay. So, I don't quite see why that should be. That would be incorporated here. So that's a modeling question. How would you model the cost? But when is, so my question is, when is future? So let me give you an idea, okay? So in this case, I was talking about 40 years timeline, okay? In this case, assume that t to t plus 1 is just 1 millisecond, okay? So within 1 second, you have 1,000 seconds. You have gone 1,000 steps within 1 second. Within a day, you have more than 1 million steps. How many? Maybe 100 million steps, or perhaps even more than that. Okay? So in that particular situation, you want to use an average cost, because what's going to happen at the end of the day is also as important as what's going to happen now. Things are not going to change that much within a day. because the time scale is so fast. Okay, so if you're looking at internet where packets are routing and you know you're sending emails, actually terabytes of data get sent on a day-to-day basis, and things happen at milliseconds or microsecond scale, average cost becomes important in those situations. You don't want to discount the future, because future is just 1 second later or 2 seconds later in those systems. So here, future is as important as today. It's merely the issue of time scale. So this is at much longer time scale, days, weeks, months, years, whereas this one is the time scale is very short. The time scale of action is very short. So most of the real-time problems where you have to take an action every millisecond or every microsecond, you would like to use average cost MDP formulation. Okay. Now the question, the key question that we would like to answer is, under what conditions can I find an, okay, actually the other thing I want to talk about here. So remember, this is a policy, and this policy goes all the way to infinity. So at every point of time, oh, I erased it. So remember that at mu t, the set of mu t has cardinality u raised to s. If I have to store a billion of such mu t's, it's also a problem. So what would you do? What would your modus operandi be if just one time step, the number of policies is this much? If you add infinite time steps, it's only going to grow from there. So what your modus, what should be your modus operandi? What should you do as far as the policy is concerned? Any thought? Remember, each of these mu t is a map from S to U. So mu 0 is a map from S to U, mu 1 is a map from S to U, mu 2 is a map from S to U. Okay. So it would be elegant if I don't have to store mu t for every t, if I could just store one mu from S to U. Let's say I store mu bar from S to U. And I have the result which says that j of mu 0, mu 1, and of course mu infinity is the same as mu bar and so on. Okay, I don't know whether this works or not. But it would be elegant. Okay, so in this case, I have to store a lot of functions. In this case, I just have to store one function and act according to that every time step. So it turns out that this is true. So there's a question mark here. This is true. This kind of policy is known as stationary policy. So stationary policy means that the policy doesn't change with time. It remains stationary. Okay, this is a time-dependent policy. For every time-dependent policy, you can find a stationary policy. That gives you, I think there should be a greater than equal sign. So that gives you the same, or at least a lower cost in comparison to the time-dependent policy. Time-dependent Markov deterministic policy. Okay, so stationary policy is even a smaller subclass of Markov deterministic policy, because Markov deterministic allows you to change your policy with time. Stationary doesn't even allow that, so you have to fix your policy. And it turns out that stationary policy would be globally optimal for total cost MDP, discounted cost MDP, and average cost MDP. So you can find one stationary policy which is optimal in one of, in any of this problem. okay? So over period of time, over this entire lecture, what we have done is we started with history-dependent randomized. We zeroed into Markov deterministic policies. Now we are going even smaller and restricting ourselves to stationary policy because we soon realize that even time-dependent policy is a problem to have. And thankfully, because your MDP is stationary, which means that the transition probability doesn't change with time, your cost function doesn't change with time. So remember, C doesn't have a time dependent, C is not time dependent. So C is the same cost throughout the horizon. This C is the same throughout the horizon. This C is the same throughout the horizon. So this is the reason why a stationary policy is optimal. Yes?
So an MDP can be the stationary policy. I mean, what if we change the mu 1 to mu 2 or mu 3?
Here? This is the same policy throughout. That's what the definition of. If you want to change it?
Yeah, want to change it to mu 2.
It's not going to help you. It's not going to improve your expected cost. So why would you change a policy? Let's say you have figured that in the morning you should always eat sandwich, and in the afternoon you should always eat rice. If you have fixed that policy, and that seems to be an optimal policy for you, why would you want to change it? Right? So I don't know if you know, but Mark Zuckerberg wears the same t-shirt every day. Well, not the same t-shirt, but the same colored t-shirt of the same size and the same quality on a day-to-day basis. He doesn't change it. So that's his optimal policy, okay?
Does this apply to finite horizon problem?
No, it does not. So in finite horizon, you cannot have a stationary optimal policy. The reason being that you have a terminal cost. Even if you're, so because of the fact that you are going to stop at some point of time, you cannot have a stationary policy that is optimal, globally optimal. Okay? I'm trying to come up with an analogy and I'm not able to. Mark Zuckerberg example was good. So he wears the same thing. I don't know how many of you are also following that policy. I would be curious to know. Okay. All right. So there are many questions. Question one, what stationary policy is optimal? Second is, under what conditions did I write that alpha is less than 1? So alpha is less than 1. Okay, under what conditions do we have optimality? First question is how to compute it. Okay, so these are the main questions that we would like to answer. So we want to be able to compute the stationary policy, optimal stationary policy. We want to be able to compute how to compute optimal value. And under what conditions do we have assured existence of the optimal solution? So this is going to be the subject of next class. But I want to touch upon some important points right now. Okay, so I'm trying to think. How to introduce some of those concepts. Okay. So let me talk about the total cost MDP And let me allude to what I mean for this particular point number two, which is important. So this is total cost MDP. So we are going to make the assumption C is greater than or equal to 0. So my cost is non-negative. Then the second assumption that I need to make, this is the first assumption, in order to introduce the second assumption, I need to introduce a definition. So let me introduce definition. So a stationary policy mu is said to be stationary policy mu is said to be proper if there exists a time index. There exists t greater than 0 such that the probability under the stationary policy mu of it equals to terminal state any I0 is positive for all I0. Okay? So policy is proper if there is a time t greater than equal to greater than 0 such that I reach the terminal state starting from any initial condition with positive probability. Okay. So let's think about it. If I start from here and I want to go to Dublin, I can perhaps take 315, I can take 33, I could even take Kenny Road and get to Dublin, right? So I have multiple options to go. And as long as the traffic is not very bad, in 30 minutes I can reach Dublin. Okay. Of course, usually I reach there in 15 minutes, but in 30 minutes I can reach Dublin for sure. Okay, guaranteed with one of these three policies. Now let's say I'm considering a policy where I go to Detroit and then get to Dublin. Okay, that's a policy. It's not an optimal policy, but it's still a policy. It's not a proper policy. Well, no, it is a proper policy because I'll reach there after maybe 5 hours or 6 hours, okay? It's still a proper policy, okay? What would be an improper policy? I just go to the outer space, okay? I just sit on a chair with all the rockets and then just escape to infinity, escape to space. In that case, it's an improper policy because I'll never be able to reach the terminal state, which is Dublin, starting from the initial condition, which is OSU. Okay? So that's an improper policy. So an improper policy is something where there is no hope of reaching terminal state in a finite amount of time with positive probability. Okay. So the second assumption that I want to introduce is any improper policy achieves infinite cost from some initial condition. Okay, so if I escape to infinity, if I just go to outer space and never return back to Earth, it's an improper policy because I will reach Dublin after infinite time steps. Okay, so the achievable cost in that situation is infinity. And the third assumption, so this is assumption one is C greater than or equal to zero. Assumption two is any improper policy achieves infinite cost. Third assumption is there should have at least one proper policy. There exists a proper policy. Now, third assumption is somewhat not very important, because when would you have no proper policy in your total cost MDP? It will be the case when there is something prohibiting me from getting to Dublin. So, for instance, if you have a network with nodes and paths, and then there is this point which is outside the network, and if this is the terminal state, there is no way I can reach the terminal state from any of the initial conditions. Okay? So visa restrictions, for instance, could mean there is no proper policy because you cannot reach them. Okay. You need to get visa in order to get there, and you don't have visa. All right. So if these conditions are satisfied for the total cost MDP, these three conditions, then there exists an optimal solution to the problem, and it can be computed using a value iteration algorithm. Okay. So what's value iteration algorithm? The theorem is, if 1, 2, 3 hold, then there exists mu star that is optimal, and moreover, you converts. So I want to say what value iteration is. So in value iteration, you start from V0, and then you get V1 equals to TV0. So remember, T is that Bellman operator I had introduced earlier. And V2 equals to TV1, and so on. In particular, VK plus 1 equals TVK. So iteratively, you pick any initial condition, any initial value function, iteratively apply the Bellman operator to that initial condition, and it would converge to the optimal value function V star. There are some more conditions that are needed for value iterations to converge, which I'm going to cover in the next class. But more or less, this is the theory for the total cost MDP. By the way, total cost MDP is also known as stochastic shortest path problem. Okay, just a different name for the same class of problems. Any questions so far? How do you think would we prove that such an iteration converged to V star? V star is the optimal value function. Sorry? Contraction mapping theorem? Right? So we can show that this iteration converges to V star under some conditions, of course, which I have not yet talked about. But under some condition, this iteration is going to converge to V star. And you can prove this result using contraction mapping theorem. In particular, this map T from the space of value functions to value functions is a contraction map. Okay. So where should I write? Oh, I can write it here. So what is the con- abstraction map. So T from Rn to Rn is contraction. If and only if there exists alpha, I've used alpha already. I need to use something else. Beta less than 1 such that T of, let me write as x, T of x1 minus T of x2 is less than equal to beta x1 minus x2. Okay, we have seen the use of contraction mapping theorem in 5759 when we were talking about gradient descent type algorithms. All of that, them, the convergence of gradient descent type algorithms can be proved using contraction mapping theorem. And this theorem is going to be central for convergence result for all these three problems. But one thing I want to emphasize here, so all of you are familiar with contraction mapping theorem, right? So you've taken it as part of your 5759 class. The important thing to note in the contraction mapping theorem is to find a norm on Rn for which it is a contraction. So this norm, the choice of this norm is extremely important in order to prove contraction. So in the case of total cost MDP, I am going to endow the space of value function with a very specific norm. In the case of discounted MDP, this norm would become infinity norm. In the case of average cost MDP, this norm would become what is known as a span semi-norm. Okay? So we'll talk about all these three different notions of norm. And under those notions of norm, the same operator, it's the same Bellman operator, okay? There is no difference. Same Bellman operator would become a contraction operator under different norms for different conditions, okay? So we are going to talk about it in the next class. So please review the material on contraction mapping theorem. If you haven't seen it before, I can send out, I'll upload a link on the announcement page on Carmen where I talk about contraction mapping theorem in optimization class. So please review it before you come for the next class. Use it extensively. Thank you.